the amount of interest or question or feedback, whether we can go further, we can only touch zero topics. So I will start with vector, we will start with vector effects. Are you ready? Or should we? Who is ready already? As a chief target, are you ready? So, actually, I wanted to start with vector effects since a lot of the mapping requirements are already covered by vector effects. So, but I can nevertheless start with it. So, in mapping, we usually have complex line types that are usually multi-layered lines. So, for example, we have border lines. With offset just one side, or should be combined with marker lines, and also we have complex dashing situations. I can show a few samples. So it's common to have multi-layered lines, for example, for freeways. Also, they should be dashable, if they are, of course, that's possible. There should be an option to have on the left side, like in this example, a dashed line, on the other side, a straight line. Even there should be an option to have like a hash effect in part of the line, and we have complex dashing situation. So when you dash a line, there shouldn't be a gap at the corner, for example, or you shouldn't start or end with a gap. But, so I can show some examples. Another area that is common in cartography and technical drawing is hashes, hatchings. Of course, you can do it with SVG patterns, but then often it's quite hard to do and not always possible to avoid that you can actually see the tile boundaries. I don't know if there's a really easy solution to that, or if it would be possible to have an additional tag for hashing. Do any of the panelists have comment on that?
HBGL2 and all the HB graphics languages have a hash fill which basically specifies the lines to fill the polygon with, so that is a feature in the existing language that would perform this for you, so maybe that could go into SVG. One other thing I just want to mention on the subject of mapping, Abravigilize is implementing the SVG map profile for KDDI in Japan, and just following on from Rob's talk, one of the features of that profile is a level of detail attribute that can go on any element. So as you zoom in that map, things become visible. As you zoom out, you can basically specify minimum and maximum zoom levels to look at different levels of detail, and that's kind of tailor-made for this application.
And the other issue we often have is variable stop width. So, for example, in a river network, you want to end or start with a single line, and as the river goes in size, it should be adaptable. This is an example for dashing. So, you want to avoid having gaps at the sharp corners. This is something I don't know. Maybe there should be an authoring tool solution for this. I'm not sure if it should be a mistake. Maybe it should be discussed with the implementers whether there is a possible solution for that. And as you can see here, we shouldn't have all the three lines should start with the same. There shouldn't be like a huge dash for this line and direct connection to the other line. So it usually should be when lines dashed lines meet, they should be nice joining. And often you want to start with a dash and end with a dash, and not start with a dash and end with a gap or something like this.
So I was just going to say that's also an HPGL feature. There's an adaptive stroke that when you do dash lines, it will adjust the dash offset so that you beginning and end on proper dash boundaries. Yeah.
There's one other request we have as members. I shamelessly copied this from Umut Lang and Armin Müller. So when we get an event in mapping, we often have multiple layers above each other, maybe with opacity or patterns where you can see the other elements through, and you want to get to all the events, the hits of all the layers. even if you so currently you can only get the topmost layer of the event target. And there could be additional DOM methods like get computed area or maybe some extended heap testing, not just objects with the bounding box, but maybe object with object or things like that, overlap tests and so on. There are a lot more requirements. Some of them are in the vector effects. Are you ready, Chris? Are there any additional comments on mapping? I'm sure there are a few mapping classes here.
You mentioned that you want select different layers or more than one layer, more than the top layer. Is it dependent on the visibility if we see it on the screen or if we don't see it? Or in general, even if a rect is not visible under a special other rect, for example?
If it's in the DOM tree, they want to get the hits. If it's not that is
independent, if it is overlapped by another rect or not.
I think that sort of thing can be handled by an attribute that says basically your event continues. Normally you swallow your event, you send it back up. But basically forwarding the events down, pushing them down. So you'd have to opt in to that behavior. You wouldn't do the normal behavior. I think that's how I would do it.
I have one.
Okay.
I had a question on the... Okay.
Sing, do something.
I'll sing.
Alice?
No.
No. Question?
Yeah. On your requirements for mapping, do you have any needs for labels and adding contrast for labels towards the background? Because one of the problems I've heard about is the ability to outline text so there's better contrast with the background, and it simply doesn't really allow you to do this because if you struggle the text, you have a bad rendering, and the only thing you can do is to actually.
Ideally, it would be handled by proper masking, so certain layers could be masked off, but others shouldn't. Because if you have a light background, you wouldn't want to mask it, but
yeah.
If it's
like
a black or a darker color, you would probably want to mask it.
Okay.
It's possible, but current implementations are quite slow, usually if you introduce masks over the whole map reach.
Right, so because that's one requirement we've seen, and the other thing I just want to mention is that a lot of the things you've described on mapping, I mean, I shouldn't say a lot, but some of them, in particular the way that the stroke is grown compared to the shape, we also find in UI applications. So sometimes it's actually important to be able to offset the strokes to get really precise designs. So designers come with designs, and the stroke is actually not centered on the path outline. So I think it's pretty common in mapping, but it's also seen in UI applications.
Yeah. I'm always happy to see that cryptographers are not the only process request and it just increases the chances that they will be implemented somewhere. David?
One more comment on the mapping issue, and that is that sometimes you have a geographical object like the place where two rivers flow together and form a new river. And you want the label of that point to change locations at different levels of zoom. And you want the font to perhaps disappear at certain levels of zoom. And it seems as though attractors and repellers as a part of the layout model might become very handy at some point in time.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about vector effects. So you're already familiar with normal filter effects, which SVG has, because we don't have vector displays. So at some point, the vectors have to get rasterized to be displayed. And the current filter effects take that raster and do stuff with it, basically. They intercept it on the way to the display. So vector effects is another way to intercept another part of the pipeline. You're probably familiar with it. In fact, Vincent Hardy just mentioned this. If you take text and you stroke it, then the stroke is on top, and that's usually almost always what you don't want. It looks ugly. You lose completely the shape of the text. Whereas if you put the stroke underneath, then it's legible and you can see it. And the obvious way to do that, and in fact the way I did this diagram, is you draw it twice, and then the accessibility people want your head because that's bad. So. What vector effects is simply a way to say, okay, I'd like this to happen in the other order. I'd like markers first, and then fill, and then stroke, or whatever it is. That's the simplest part of it. This is the primer I'm going through, by the way. Doug mentioned yesterday we started to have primers for our specs. So this isn't the actual language spec. This is just something that's an introduction. It seemed like a good thing to scroll through. And you can see that the one about compound shapes, which was mentioned earlier in the conference, just says at, because I get to write that part. But you've seen that idea that you have multiple pieces and you can pull them together into one sort of super path or compound. So here's an example. What we've done is we've taken this heart shape, and what we've, in the first case, we've just filled and stroked it. Second case, we've taken the stroke, but we've applied transform before we render the stroke. And in the third one, what we did was we took the shape and then drew it or made it larger, and I'll show how that works. So the idea is you can apply fill and stroke and markers in any order. You can apply them multiple times so that you can have multicolored strokes or different thickness and strokes, that sort of thing. You can transform them before they're rendered. You can do sort of constructive geometry. You can do union and intersection. And you can convert strokes into paths, convert markers into paths. So here's an example. What we've done is we've just taken that path, we've taken the stroke, converted it to a path, and then stroked that. So that was a fairly simple operation. And here we've simply stroked it multiple times with three different thicknesses of stroke. You can reverse elements, which is useful for compound paths, but it's also useful if the markers go the other way around. Sometimes you need that.
It's also useful for animation.
Yes, it's also, indeed, it's also useful for animation. So here's a union. I've got two shapes, and I've said union those. The color is just because I had to fill it with something. You don't get a combination of pink and green. Last time I presented this, people were like, how do you work out that orange? I said, well, I just picked a colour around. So don't read too much into the colour. You can fill it with whatever you want. So here's an example. You take a shape, you make a thick stroke on it, you convert the stroke to a path, so you now have two paths, and then you union them, so you've grown the path outwards. And similarly, you can intersect, so here I've got two shapes and I've got the intersection of one with the other. Obviously you can do that both ways, depending on which way you want to go. Same operation here, but now I've excluded. I've taken my stroke, converted it to a path, and then subtracted the two. So this gives me a grow-in operation. What I haven't got here, but something I'm hearing that people want to do is asymmetric. So we want to be able to take the stroke and offset it out. Now you can do that by a series of operations. I mean, you could build a complex filter that sort of does a thin one, does a thick one, subtracts them, whatever. But it's probably easier to can that effect and say you want the stroke to be offset by a certain amount because it's computation. So here's some examples of how this would actually look. So this is a basic vector effect that gives you non-scaling line width, non-scaling fill patterns, one that strokes twice. That's a comment to me that I need to add something to the main spec because I've used it here in the example, but it doesn't exist, so I better define it. The simple one, which I started off with the stroking of the text, that one's here. You notice these are all four-line things. Okay, the real examples get a bit bigger because, like the other vector effects, you can say n equals this and out equals that. Here, there are no inputs and no outputs. It's just taking the one piece of geometry. There we go. There's a shared border one. As well as the normal ways of specifying paint, you can also have some special keywords like current fill, current stroke. So what you can do, for example, you can take something that has markers, you can convert the marker to a path, which will flatten the whole thing. And so if you have multicolored markers, you now have a single union shape for that. And then you can fill it with the predefined current stroke, which means you get a line of a particular color, and the markers on it are the same color as the line, which is something that people want all the time. And that's pretty easy. That's just like a five-line vector effect, which then you can... And then, of course, if you use that line multiple times and put multiple strokes on it, then all the markers will just automatically do that.
You could also have something marker it says to use it.
You could. That's another way to do it. But it sort of naturally falls out of the syntax anyway. It's an easy way to do it. And you could do it. You could say, I want it for the fill color, or you could say, I want the fill of the shape to be the marker's fill color, or there's various other options. So that's the basic quick run through of the vector effects. I must admit that this spec has just sat there while we've got on with other things. If you saw this last year or the year before, it looked much the same, honestly. But now that we've got 1.1 pretty much out the door, I'd like to be looking much more at this, and indeed encouraging some implementations, because these things are all faked up in Inkscape, frankly. And it'd be much easier to play with this stuff if I had implementation to work with.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
Okay. First off, it's great to see that things have moved quite a bit since Peter Sjortjørgen started to talk about this years ago, so congratulations. One question I have is, this is all awesome, I think, but what about APIs for that? Because very often I find that it would be great to actually have the APIs to do an exclude and a new combination of shapes and actually get it back. And while I'm talking about this, it would be the same thing for text. There's been talk about SVG fonts, and on my end, the only real requirement or usage I see for SVG font is the ability to get to the outline of the glyphs. So if there was a generic way in SVG along with VectorFX to actually access the geometry of what you draw, that's really all you need. I mean, it doesn't really matter which font format you use, but that's one thing that SVG fonts give us. If we get rid of the SVG font, then it would be nice in VectorFX maybe to have access to the outline of text.
Yeah, what I was thinking there was a simple method, probably on each of the vector primitives, but also on the overall vector effect, that just says basically, give me this whole thing, this tree, outside the main tree, just give me a thing which I can stitch in anywhere I want. I can either use it to replace where it came from, or in addition, if I'm making multiple copies of different values of vector effects. And I think that would be quite useful. So you end up with a little factory that you can basically trot through the main geometry and pull these things out and populate your tree with them. Quite nice.
Yeah, that would be great. Thanks.
Thanks for the comment. I'm wondering if there are any use cases in the audience we can see for those types of vector effects. Obviously, cartography is one, and designers are requesting them.
I can give one use case. For simple UI use cases where imagine you want to do a window with like a little bubble in the corner. The easiest way to do this would be able to define a random rect, combine it with a circle, and then you want to stroke the outline of the combined shape, because that would be the visual rendering you want to do. And that's an elegant rendering, and the right way would be with vector effects.
In animation, the separation of parts of a path so that you could animate separate parts. As Donald Duck moves his arm, he's not moving his beak. So that the entity remains connected. So that last thing with VE path could be really handy in animation and also in computer assisted manufacturing, where you have complex machines, the components of which act like a group.
Okay, I did not think about animation, but isn't it the future of an editor? So I know that Inkscape is combining parts and something like that. I think the future of drawing the stroke and the flow on top of it is cool, but the union and intersection of parts, I think it's a feature that should be going to editors and not really in the viewers.
So yes, it is a feature in some editors. The point is, though, that if I want text that's got five different strokes behind it, increasing width, and I do that in an editor, what I end up with is five paths which look like text. If I do that in the browser, I have one text with a property on it which does that, and I can still edit that text. I can still change it through the DOM, and the effect will propagate. So if it's static and you don't mind the bloat on file size, then yes, you can do it in an editor, obviously. In fact, that's how I did most of the stuff was in Inkscape, using the union and intersection things. But to me, that shows that it's tractable, it is doable. Inkscape doesn't sit there for 2 minutes cogitating, it just does it. So it should be possible. It might not be very fast if you're animating it, but that was why I was thinking more of the sort of DOM map aspect, that you might even hide this stuff and have it churn away and do it. But it's constructing it on the fly in the client, which means you're sending a small file down, and then it is producing stuff on the fly like this little factory. So I can see your argument, and in some cases, yes, it's easier to just do the more complex, just generate all this stuff and then and save. But in some cases, it's not.
And there are also edits like SVG edit that would benefit if it's available in browser. And they could do it in JavaScript with computation, but they probably won't do it. Maybe not all of the effect. Okay, are there any initial comments on the vector effects from other implementers? Okay, but we can move to SVG parameters.
So I'm actually going to talk about three different things. Parameters is one of them. And these, I do have specs for two of these things. One of them I don't have a spec for yet, but these are still proposals. We've talked about them in the working group, but these are not things that I can't guarantee that they will happen, or if they do happen, when they will happen. But it'd be interesting to hear your feedback. So, curve between points. So, sometimes you have several points, and you just want to draw a line between them, a nice curve between them. You can do this with cubic Bezier's. And you can see that Bezier's add extra points that are not on the line, and you need to adjust those. So it's powerful, but it's not necessarily intuitive if you just want a simple line between things. So I did a little research, and I stumbled upon Catmull ROM splines, and these are blah, 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 math involved here, whatever. So I'm emulating them. I have a little script implementation, and I emulate Catmull ROM splines. Basically, they're a set of points on a curve, and one of the nice things is that adding an extra point on the curve only changes the previous segment. You'll see what I mean in a moment. There's also a sort of a tension parameter saying how tightly you want to curve to that shape in using the Catmull-ROM curves. But for the purposes of adding this SVG, I would propose we do not have a tension parameter. It basically, it's just a set of points. And you start to be in a path element, and you'd say P set of points, and then it would just draw a smooth curve between them. And I will demonstrate said curve. So, example. You can see as I'm adding points that it's just adding them to, it's just changing the previous line set, or the previous path segment.
Yeah, you've done this before.
So, actually, this is one of the worst turtles I've done. I practiced it over the past couple of days. This is terrible. But
It looks pretty nice, but let me show you something that's not... Oh, that's how I refresh. Oh, I do this. Yeah. Okay, so let me show you something that's not intuitive. Okay, so I want to make a simple rounded rectangle with just a set of points. Should be pretty easy. Okay, and hey, what's going on up there? This is not what I wanted. So you can see, that is not the rounded rectangle I was expecting. So it doesn't always produce exactly what you would expect, but it does always produce something. And for a lot of us, that's actually... So if you wanted to do a simple, if you wanted to do a simple, you had a bunch of points for a data chart. Yeah, that's good. So that is... Calderon curves. Let's see, parameters. Who here is not familiar with parameters? Okay, so a couple people. All right, I'm going to go through these really quickly because I think most people are pretty familiar with them. Anybody else can come up to me and ask me later. So it's the idea is reusable components. Specifically, I'm talking about parameters in SVG. It's a new proposal we have. So it would help make reusable components. So you can pass parameters into an object, to an SVG file, or into a use element as either the param element, using the param element, or the URL parameters in a URL. And inside the SVG, the attribute, you would have a param function as the attribute value, and you'd give it a name. So if I called my thing Bill, if I called my parameter Bill, and if I passed in Bill, and I said the value was orange, whatever, you know, orange would just get plugged in wherever that parameter is. And there's a spec and there's a primer. And I'm just going to show you. I'm just going to show you very quickly. Here's the syntax. I don't know if you can see it very well. Here is the parameter syntax in the URL. And here's an example. So here we have a button, and this is the same button. All these are exactly the same button, but I'm passing in different parameters. This one says stop, and it's red. This one says fast, and it's amber. And this one says go, and it's green. So these are all the same button. They're all references. So if you're reusing the same component a lot of times, you can reuse it much more efficiently here. I'm just going to give you a quick example. Like, here's another example. I have a home map, and I've passed in some coordinate values right here. And here it's in North Carolina, and here it's in Japan. Those are the two places that I work. And it's the same map. I just move the little dot around automatically. And this is all declarative, of course, so there's no script involved. Except right here, there is script involved because this is a script implementation. Here I'm passing in a different URL for the same ad. And here I'm using a use element, and I'm passing different parts of the flower have different uses, and so I'm passing in different colors to different parts of the flower. And here's a bar chart, and you get the point. Okay, moving on.
Is this something that should be aligned with HTML would be useful for other languages?
The CSS working group has also expressed an interest in this, so I would expect this to also work in HTML. Yeah. At least in the CSS aspect of HTML. I don't know about HTML values. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I mean, there's two places you could put it, right? You could put it as a CSS property value, and you could put it in HTML as an actual attribute value. And that requires two sets of people as to whether you get to do one or the other.
Quick question. Yep. How do you set the default value? It's the second value. So if I say param blah, I mean param bill, then green. The default value is green.
Is there any advantage to using this over just generating it with?
Is there any advantage to using this over just generating it with like XSLT? Because it's very easy to imagine how you would do the same thing. You know, you just have an XSL template with most of your SVG content in it. You have a param in there, and then it generates your SVG.
Sorry, I heard blah 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 XSLT blah blah, and I couldn't understand it. Most people can't use XSLT.
Why?
Because they can't use it. They don't. It's not in their heads. It's not in their tool chain.
this thing, this is a static file, and no matter where I'm using this, they just pass it. It's just all I have to do is know that this thing has a name, and then can give the value.
It just seems like a duplication of functionality.
It is if it's static. If you're passing parameters in dynamically and changing them in response to mouse over events or things like that, then it's not static, and you can't really do anything using XSLT. But yes, for a static case, you could do much the same templating type thing using XSLT, if you knew how to.
I don't understand how this is dynamic, though. It seems like you're passing in static variables.
Yeah, but you're passing in variables. The variables can change.
I think there are additional comments on Vincent and Ted.
Yeah, I just want to echo what Doug said. In the world of web development, HTML, JavaScript, CSS, and we're trying to add SVG. XML is really not a part of the world. XSLT is like so far not in that world that it's not worth talking about.
Well,
sorry.
Well,
okay, it's worth talking about, but it's.
I've been taking a lot of questions on this particular feature from the folks I know, and they want it on IMG, on the image tag in HTML.
Sure.
Yeah. So, I mean, it is the pattern that's expected.
Yeah, so one comment, I think this is it's great to be able to parameterize SVG in general. And actually, on my wish list, what I'd have, especially in relation with reconciling SVG and CSS, for example, is I think there's a general need to parameterize, say, filter effects, and then be able at use time to exercise those parameters. Because if you look at the differences between the CSS shadows, for example, and SVG shadows. I think you could reconcile them if you were able to express, filter effects in SVG and say, what is the blur factor, what is the offset, and then agree on CSS as to how you parameterize a CSS property and bind it to that definition.
Right.
I think in general that would be a very useful solution because you could then define a whole set of filters and then use them.
So the underlying mechanism would be the same mechanism that's used with params, you wouldn't have to use the syntax, you just use the underlying mechanism. Because if you say basically pre-canned filter effects.
Right. I guess my point is I think there are two sides to the parameter, to defining parameters and making and parameterize something. One is a definition, in which you're going to express what is variable that can be changed at use time. And the other way is how you exercise it. So I think you showed a great example of how you do this, but in my mind, at least, I could see a CSS property that does exactly the same thing.
Just, I have also a comment. Can you parameterize events? Like, I want to trigger...
I hadn't thought about it.
Okay, I want to trigger an event based on key, or based on a touch, or based on a click.
Interesting.
Okay, I have a follow-on question to what he said. So here's the concern I have with a feature like this, is that it hasn't been fully thought out. So for example, and please don't shut down me when I say XSLT. All right, come back. So what happened with XSLT? In XSLT, they came up with this idea that you can pass links to another transform. I mean, if you know XSLT, you know what I'm talking about. And so what happens is, and I'm kind of thinking, this is a nice paper for the next SVG Open 2011, is I'll repeat a experiment that someone did with XSLT, and that is I will, once you guys figure this out, depending on which browser vendor implements which semantics, I will then do an implementation of the Lambda calculus using this technique. The idea is, if you introduce the syntax here, there are a variety of things I haven't heard you talk about. What's the binding? What's the context? What's the lifetime? What's the scope? In other words, the scope is, what's the region of text that's affected by the parameter? You put the name of a variable or something here. Where does that variable take effect?
So
lifetime is the variable? And now when you start adding in events, when you start adding in the namespace of CSS, when I make a change to the CSS name, in there, is CSS, is that part of the scope? Is it just the text between the begin and ending SVG tag? I think
I see. So, obviously, I didn't explain the spec to you. I just wanted to give you an overview of the ideas. You should read the spec if you're interested in those questions.
Okay.
I don't know that I answer all of them. And you, what you should do is use send feedback. I can tell you honestly, I'm not very happy with this spec as it stands. I think it needs a lot of work. I think the idea is good, but I think it needs a lot of work. But with regards to the math, I'm a vegetarian. I don't consume lambda, so you're gonna have to dumb it down for me.
I guess my only concern is that if it's someone that doesn't understand lambda,
that was a joke. So
you risk defining two.
Read the spec. Okay. Tell me where it goes wrong and send in feedback.
I just would give you some end user input, because I'm just a web designer, and when I see that, I think this is just awesome. Because it's a really interesting shortcut for things that I already done. For example, I do that by server-side, like auto-generating SVG on the fly, or do it with JavaScript. So this is a very interesting shortcut for end users.
And that's exactly what it's meant for. It does enable some new functionality, but it's mostly a community thing. So moving on. Sorry.
I have such a question. If it is like loops, when you put smooth code around rectangular, what prevents you to use not a Catmull-Rose client, but something I can explain it worse. Loop. You may, if you have same points, you may take a row and put this rope through the set of points. You get zigzag. Do you understand? You may take a flexible steel ruler. Yeah. But any intermediate situation is possible too. Do you understand?
Right.
And if you use a ruler with tension, you can adjust only one single parameter, and this exclude all loops.
I think I understand what you're saying, but my goal in doing the Catmull-ROM, what I'm calling the Catmull-ROM curves, the Catmull-ROM splines, is maximum simplicity. Basically, somebody just has a set of points, and they just want to dump it in there, and they want a result. If you want to really tweak things, that's what you have the Bezier for.
No, it's absolutely simple.
Okay, so maybe you...
And I can show you later.
Yeah, absolutely. That's
okay.
Fine. I just did Catmull-ROM because it was the first thing that seemed to work with what I wanted to do.
Okay.
So, kind of running a long time, I just want to show briefly something that we're working on now called connectors. Basically, what are connectors? Connectors are essentially graphs. When people think of graphs, they usually think of network graphs, or if you're a nerd, you think of network graphs. Also, graphs are used for organization charts, flow charts. A kind of organization chart is a family tree. That's something that an everyday person might want to do. Kinds of flow charts, schematics, electronic diagrams, things like that. And networks, social networks, are something that pops out as a graph and as a connector. So what would connectors do? Connectors are a new element that would essentially say, I want to connect this element with this other one, this node with this other node. So it's a semantic connection between sheets. It's not just visual. It's not just drawing a line between things. It actually says these two things are connected. You can also add extra semantics. You can give a title to it. You can give a description of the nature. You can give a textual description of what the link is, why, what the connection, what the relationship between these things are. And you can also specify the directionality of the connection, if there is a directionality. And there's also behavior that's tied to it, and I think this is the key to it. The visual line is automatically updated if you reposition nodes. It's just a straight line between the centroids. I'll explain a little bit more. I'll demonstrate in a moment. You can also style the appearance of the connector, and you can have there's a list of connections. Like if you're on a node, if you're focused on a node, there'd be a list of connections for the other nodes that connect to that node. So for accessibility purposes, that's good. Ted, you can criticize me later. I'm sure you have much more thoughts about this than I have. What won't connectors do? Connectors will not dynamically position nodes. You have to delay that out manually or via script. There's no concept of weight on a node or connector. You can add metadata to do that if you need to for your own purposes. It will not automatically avoid intersection of lines and shapes. It won't curve around shapes. And the connectors may cross. This means these are hard problems to solve, and we don't want to solve them in the language. Correct. It does not allow automatic drag and drop of elements. You have to, again, add that via script. Secondary note, the SVG working group is planning on making it much easier to get the real coordinates of the mouse with transforms and view boxes. Okay, so one of the things you might not think about when you think about graphs is floor plans. Somebody, at least here, who did the audio demo, did an awesome audio demo, and the floor plans can be laid out as a kind of graph. Like, different rooms are different nodes, and there are connections between them. Other things, tube maps. This is an obvious connection. So actually, it's around the tube.
This is Metro.
When I first did this, the part of this presentation, I was in London. So, and I did swap it out for the Metro. I did swap out the image. So, so here is a simple example. It's just a simple black line. This is sort of the default. And as I drag this around, ooh, oh my gosh, that's astounding. No one's ever seen that before. So here's another example where I've styled them. So I have I've thickened the stroke. I've added markers. I've made this, if this is a decision tree, this is a little flowchart. If this is a decision tree, it'd be red and green. I forgot to load up one of my. Oh, wait, just a second. I forgot to load up one of my examples, but it doesn't matter. Good question, Chris. Thank you. So, this slide actually. Oh, and also I have dashes here. This slide actually demonstrates another aspect of it. We're introducing the concept of a point in SVG. Point does not render. It's just a point. You could add a marker on top of that point to make it render, but as it stands, by itself, it does not render. So right now, you see it's moving along those connectors. And actually, you can see as I move this around, there's a little script implementation of connectors. It's going to specific points on these shapes. And the reason for that is that I have declared points at these four points, and I've said they're ports. They're children of this larger shape, and those points are actually the ports into which something can go. Okie dokie. You all understand that. You think it's wonderful. Okay, here's another use of points. This is a simple hierarchical sort of chart, sort of an org chart. And right here, I've declared a point inside the connector. Right here, I've declared a point inside the connector. This is really clumsy, but sometimes for the layout, it would be something that people probably use, might be useful for people. Those points are static. They don't move. I assume if I put a marker around there, I could drag it around, blah, 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 blah. Here's the final part of this, and that is you can actually give a role that a connector must tie into. So in other words, this is an output. This is not going to change, this red one. These yellow ones, these are all inputs. So as I move this around, you get the point. This one, this connector says, I can connect to any port. And this connector says, I am only connecting to this output port. So handy dandy. And again, all this would be handled automatically, except for the drag and drop. That was another really awesome demo I'm not going to show you because I'm right. But it was the best one, really. So why connectors? Okay, why should SVG add something as complex as connectors? Okay, first off, it was one of the pieces of original input into the SVG specification. There's a spec called Web Schematics by David Deuce, is it Deuce or David Deuce, and Bob Hopgood in 1998. this was one of the four or five specs that went into SVG originally. It didn't make the cut because connectors were seen as too complex, but I think that we've got a nice simplified solution here. Why
else? Because why else? Because there's no real common standard for graphs. There are lots of different standards for doing graphs, but none of them is dominant in the marketplace and for interchange and things like that. And none of them, none of the existing standards actually talk about the that I could find. Somebody can correct me. Talk about the visual representation, how the thing is laid out. And that's actually the thing that most people care most about in the graphs. They actually care about how what it looks like. It aids accessibility. You can have logical connectors. You can even have invisible connectors, like with a floor plan, that connect things without you having to see that there's a connection. There's just a logical connection there. And it solves a large number and a wide variety of real-world use cases. I think this is one of those things that's nice and neat that might help adoption of SVG for just common users. People can say, oh, I can use SVG to immediately just do this one of these large number of sets of problems that I am encountering. Okay, so I'm not convincing you, but I'm convinced. Okay, let's just look at the idea of mixing connectors with parameters. You can define shape primitives, like I did with the flowchart, and you can pass in the text that goes into those things. Word wrapping would also be nice, or text wrapping would also be nice for those. You can pass in the style info, pass it in labels, so you can use a primitive, a decision node or a whatever node, and pass in parameters to give those, to put text in. I didn't show text because I didn't have time. Kappa ROM splines. You can imagine having, instead of those straight lines, if you define a point, the Kappa ROM spline goes right through that. That would be nice. And vector effects, rich connector styles. So you can have really rich, meaningful connector styles that are, you know, double lines and things like that, more than just the dash decoration. And that's it. So future of SVG, blah, 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 closer integration with HTML, SVG, and CSS, blah, blah, blah. This is from, never mind. I just wanted to show off the clock.
You mentioned it between lines. We'll have points in SVG. That's actually great for cartoons.
There's a number of different reasons we want to add points, and this just happens to be one of them. Adding points is actually a really useful concept.
Exactly.
Yeah. No. Just because you said.
I was just wondering if you could elaborate quickly on the shared target notation, like in the org chart, and had kind of hyper edges or something like that. Could you explain?
I didn't. Actually, each of those was a single connection. It is a one-to-one relationship. Each connector connects to exactly two nodes. And they just have an overlap.
I'm sorry, but we need to go to this presentation.
Okay. This will be, it'll be less than 5 minutes, I think. These are some of the things I presented already. Some of these in my talk. Just go through them in here. It's more bigger audience, probably. The biggest thing we want, the number one complaint we have, the most reported bug, is the lack of the markers taking the property of the path. So how we do that, how we fix that, we can discuss, but that's something that really, really needs to be fixed. The other thing from an artist standpoint is having mesh gradients of some sort. This is something we get requests for all the time, and people have actually tried to see how with using filters or other means, can you simulate mesh gradients right now in the SVG standard? The thing, I don't know if this will... No, I'll just go to the next. Oh, you could go. Let's see how I scroll down. here, this is diffusion curves where you can get gradients along a path, then fill in it with a very simple set of strokes. You can get quite nice pictures. This is something that, that people have talked about. Okay, let's see. Yeah. Vector effects. Of course, we want all the vector effects that have already been discussed. Here's some things that people have asked for. Paths constructed with subpaths, so you can have different attributes along a path. Objects that share paths. You've heard this from the mapping people. It's something that we get requests for. Another thing is control over the stroke position. Is the stroke, the normal stroke is evenly spaced 50-50 on either side of the path. People would like to be able to happen on the inside, on the outside, or change a percentage. Layers. Inkscape uses groups to make layers. It'd be nice to have it formalized. So other, you know, for example, this presentation right here is done using layers with a bunch of JavaScript. Multi-page SVGs we get requests for, multi-line text entry. Another big one for artists is perspective transforms. Can you take something like a box and without having to distort, lose the boxness, put that in a 3D effect. Embedded fonts, we get requests for. And here's there's a pattern fill. This might be also useful for maps. A filter that would take this sphere and then convert it to using those shapes, patterns. Place them on top based on the color of the sphere. This is done using Inkscape's tiling feature that allows you to place tiles or copies of an image, clones of an image, pattern over an object based on what's beneath it. But what I show you here is it's got 8,000 little circles, which takes a lot of time to render. This is actually a pain because you can't do that in SVG, really. And then there's some things that we'd like to have within the filters changes. For example, the default color space should be the same for filters and for objects. An FD drop shadow primitive would be nice to have, too. As mentioned already in this conference, constructing pending like that is a multi-step process right now. What I have. Oh, one more thing that I left out of the pattern. The path effect. It'd be nice to be able to put a path along a path. We have text along a path. That's something that Inkscape does, but of course, once you do it, you can't. You can undo it in Inkscape. Inkscape stores the data for undoing it, but nobody else can take Inkscape. We can do both.
Are we eliminate primitive subregions? Why can't we just eliminate filter regions as well and introduce a new effect like FE clip effect or something like that?
I haven't really thought about this one. That was a suggestion from somebody on our mailing list.
Basically, his argument was the subregion is to allow a browser or renderer to know what region.
Yeah, we do it at the moment in that case, but it's not enough optimization. We still have to calculate the smallest track that we have to do.
Exactly, and you could use a clipping path or something else to define that region that you're interested in. So it's there are other ways of doing this without having those kinds of problems, maybe.
Okay, so we need to close it up so we can discuss the additional issues we have or ideas. Originally, we planned this for a 2.5-hour workshop. but for some reason the workshops is not so used for different things. And we use the demo instead of if. The advantage is large audience, but it time restrictions, of course. So I hope that in a couple of years, at least, some of the ideas will make it into the spec and be useful for the content authors. And I'm wondering in 5 years if we have the ideas. So thanks for the discussion, and thanks.